coming along with. And speaking of planning ahead, please let me know if you're interested in serving on a particular committee. I do try to peruse and keep up with the applications of new members as they come through, because we do ask, is there a certain committee area that you're interested in? But I very much welcome, I would like to have a volunteer who's doing what they wish to do versus what I draft you to do. So please let us know. And speaking of that, you know, we're always looking ahead. We're a member-run organization, and so it's important that we're constantly preparing the tomorrow's leaders of the club. And in our club bylaws, it does give us a little bit of guidance. They encourage us to rotate committees such that we're only serving for 3 consecutive years on any given committee, just to cross-pollinate and get new ideas. And to be considered for board election, you must have served as a committee chair or a very active member of a committee. So hopefully we'll get you all enlisted there. Finally, the PBR World Finals are going to be here, held in Fort Worth for the first time. We know that they're going to be here for at least the next 3 years. And there is a PBR parade in the Stockyards. That's Professional Bull Riders World Finals. And we are finalizing plans now, but we're tentatively planning to participate in that parade. There are 2, both in the Saturday right after the herd runs. So around 11:35 a.m. for about an hour on May 14th and May 21st. And we're especially looking for Western riders. And Courtney is quite an equestrian, but she needs a horse. So if anybody has a horse as well, and we welcome all of you to participate, and we also welcome any fun ideas you have. Thank you.
I'm Sean. Okay, and now for an announcement about the Crazy Pants Golf Tournament. Tim Howden, Enterprise Account Executive, Charter Communications. Tim?
Thank you, President Courtney. Good afternoon, everyone. Just a reminder that the Crazy Pants Golf Open will be May 16th at Ridgely Country Club. Noon lunch, 1 p.m. shotgun start, and probably around 5 o'clock we're going to have a wine and whiskey tasting for everyone. But today we want to talk about sponsorships. So we've put together a little flyer on most people's tables talking about what sponsorships are available. I'm proud to say that we have already sold the putting green sponsor and the golf cart sponsor. So if your organization, thank you, yeah, that's great, isn't it? If your organization's interested in helping out with the golf tournament, this would be a great way to do it. Get a little free PR, some press. I guess it's really not free, but a little press, visibility to the rest of your chamber members, that'd be great. If you have any questions, please reach out to Aurora, myself, or the chairman of the committee, Blair Hancock. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. And now for a second reading, we welcome our secretary, Rebecca Montgomery, Principal Montgomery, GR. Rebecca?
Thank you, Madam President. Happy Friday, everybody. Today, we have one second reading. The following proposed new member was submitted during the March 11th program. If no objections are received through the voting process, then the proposed member will be accepted into our club. Our proposed new member is Irene Johnson. Classification, associations. Irene is a Vice President of Operations with the YMCA of Metropolitan Fort Worth. Her proposer is our own past President, Rachel Marker. I move her election subject to attending a new member Rotary information session.
All right, all in favor? She is hereby elected. Welcome to the club. Thank you, Rebecca. And now our past president, Rachel Marker, will come up and introduce our newest member.
Thank you, Madam President. It is my pleasure to introduce Judge Randall Fluke today. He is an immigration judge for the Fort Worth Immigration Court. In October of 2020, United States Attorney General William Barr appointed Randall Randy Fluke to begin serving as a U.S. immigration judge here in Fort Worth. For the previous 30 years and 30 days, from 1990 to 2020, Judge Fluke served as an assistant United States attorney for the Eastern District of Texas. As a federal prosecutor, he led in the prosecution of a broad spectrum of cases from general crimes to district's first two federal RICO murder cases. Prior to that, he served as an assistant district attorney for Lubbock and Midland counties in Texas, respectively. Beginning in 1998 and for the next 30 years, Judge Fluke concurrently served in the United States Army Reserve Judge Advocate General's Corps and retired as a colonel in 2018. Thank you for your service. Blessed to have married far above himself nearly 37 years ago, and they have three adult children. Their son, Austin, is a major and dentist in the United States Air Force. Daughter, Erin, is finishing their fifth year of residency as an orthopedic surgeon. And the youngest child, Carolyn, is an MBA working at Hanover Property Development. So he definitely breeds underachievers. Judge Fluke first became a Rotarian in 1985 with the Tahokie Rotary Club. He is a past director of the Rotary Club of Belmont, which is where he comes to us from. He was co-founder of the Westbrook High School Interact Club. He is a past recipient of the Beaumont Club's Service Above Self Award. He is a Paul Harris Fellow, and we are super excited to have Judge Fluke in our Rotary Club. Welcome, Judge, and please share a little bit about yourself.
Well, thank you so much, Rachel, for introducing me, and thank you for sponsoring me. She made quite an impression on our executive director, Jackie Chapman, who insisted whenever I came here that I meet Rachel, and I'm so glad that I did. So thank you, Rachel, and thank you, Aurora, for getting me oriented yesterday. And then a couple of things about myself. First, I regret that my wife, Emily, is not here. She's caring for her mother, who's 94, and they had appointments that couldn't be changed, but you'll meet her. And I married far above myself, as Rachel said, and you're gonna like me more when you meet Emily. Then the other thing is something unique. Okay, May the 14th, I'm going to have the honor and the privilege of officiating the wedding celebration for my son in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and that's unique. I look forward to serving with you all and to meeting all of you. Thank you.
Randall, welcome.
Thank you very much.
All right, welcome. Well, as a reminder, we are approaching 290 members, and our goal for this year was 300, so keep bringing in new members. And now for a Paul Harris Fellow Award, we welcome to the stage Kathy Sheffield, Chief Advancement Leader of Lena Pope.
Thank you so much. I get the honor and privilege of introducing you to a brand new Paul Harris Fellow. And it's my honor to also welcome this person's family who's watching virtually. So the Rotary office received a phone call from a very kind and sweet gentleman named Theodore Kern from Peoria, Illinois, where he has been a Rotarian for 52 years. He was very excited because his much beloved granddaughter had just become a Rotarian. Not just any Rotarian, but a Rotary Club of Fort Worth Rotarian. He said she was a wonderful, kind, funny individual who exemplified the true Rotarian spirit and that she would be a great one. And he wanted her to start her Rotary journey off with a Paul Harris Fellow. Mr. Kern was certainly accurate in his description of his granddaughter. Not only has she jumped in feet first, she's become a very active member, volunteering at our events, offering to help in any way she can, always bearing a huge smile and encouraging others to be their very best selves. And she just learned this morning that she won the Ad Sponsor Transit Award for Community Awareness for Fort Worth. Mr. Kern's granddaughter is our very own Abigail Dudick. Please come up here, Abby. So I'm going to pin Abby, and while I do so with my fellow Paul Harris Fellows, please stand and welcome her to as a Paul Harris Fellow. Sorry, help us welcome her and introduce her. Thank you.
to our fellow.
I love you.
Thank you. Thank you so
Thank
much.
You.
Appreciate it.
Thank you very much. And now our chairman of the day, Roland Bud Johnson. There are two Roland Johnsons in the room today. So Roland Bud Johnson, Vice President Sales, Pax and Patterson, come on up.
I won't take much time because we want to get to Fred Schlebach and Joe's presentation. But when I graduated from Texas Wesleyan in 1977, I never in my wildest dreams thought we'd have a football team and now a stadium that's on its way. So it's pretty exciting news. And I was asked to host the reveal of the new uniforms in 2017. We did it in our home. We used all four floors and had Texas memorabilia everywhere. That was very, very exciting. And so with no further ado, I'll introduce Fred Schlebach, president of Texas Wesleyan.
Thanks, Bud. It's a wonderful privilege for me to be here and to tell you about all the exciting things that are happening at Texas Wesleyan, the smaller, smarter university here in Fort Worth. I'm going to start off with some fun stuff, and then Joe is going to end with all the really important stuff. And in between, I'll give you some facts and figures and show you some pictures. But let's start with a little fun stuff. Let's see if we can. Can we advance it to the next one? Still not working. There we go.
Get an education, not a crash course. At Texas Wesleyan, big scholarships and small classes will help you soar to new heights. Texas Wesleyan, smaller, smarter.
He hit it though. Oh!
Hit the mark with big scholarships. Texas Wesleyan's big scholarships and small classes turn long shots into game changers. Texas Wesleyan, smaller, smarter.
One more.
Don't scream for attention. At Texas Wesleyan, our small classes mean you don't have to yell to get one-on-one attention. Texas Wesleyan, smaller, smarter.
We have a lot of fun with that smaller, smarter slogan. We've got a great group of marketing and communication folks that do this in-house, and they do a phenomenal job. And our Vice President for Enrollment Marketing and Communication is here with us today, Alan Liebrich. Alan, raise your hand, stand up. Thank you for everything that you're doing. It's a great honor and privilege to be here with you today. We have a number of our board members who are here from Texas Wesleyan with us today. If you're a member of the board at Texas Wesleyan University, would you please stand? Thank you for everything that you do for our students. Members of the board of trustees, Karen. So I'm going to give you a few facts and figures and then show you some pictures and then introduce Joe, who's going to talk to you about the football program and what they're doing on and off the field. Texas Wesleyan University was founded in 1890. We're a Methodist institution. We are small, and we want to stay that way. We have extremely small classes. Even in the freshman year, we have classes that average around 20 students, compared to a lot of universities that have 100, 150, 200 students in the freshman classes. We have about 1,800 students at the undergraduate level and about 700 students in graduate programs. At the undergraduate level, we're a fairly traditional pre-professional liberal arts program. At the graduate level, we have master's program in business administration. We have master's and PhD programs in counseling, master's and doctoral programs in education, and master's and doctoral programs in the health sciences, with including the largest graduate nurse anesthesia program in the United States. Every year, we graduate almost 1/10 of all the nurse anesthetists who graduate in the United States. We are also a majority-minority undergraduate institution, and about 45% of our students are Pell-eligible and first-generation college students, which is a really important niche, in my opinion, for Texas Wesleyan University. I'm a first-generation college student, and I understand how important it is to be able to have faculty and staff members who are able to get to know you because of the small community environment and actually help you thrive while you're in undergraduate school. This shows a little bit about the growth in admissions. You'll see in the fall of 2020, we had a little bit of a decline because of coronavirus, but in the fall of 21, it bounced back. In fact, we had the largest freshman class in almost a quarter of a century this past fall. We have a lot of things that are really important about what we do, and our strategic plan identifies a number of these really important aspects of who we are and what our goals are for the future. These are important concepts: critical thinking, analytical reasoning, creative problem solving. That can be done best in small classes. And we're also developing a lot of new academic programs here on the campus. I can't really read that very well, so let me just kind of skip through. We've done a lot of things on the campus, and that's what I want to really talk to you a little bit about before I bring Joe up to talk about football. Over the last 10 years, we've invested more than $50 million on campus and adjacent to the campus in the neighborhood. And this is just a list of some of the things that we've done. I want to show you just some before and after pictures. This is East Rosedale before we started our work of economic revitalization in our neighborhood. This is East Rosedale now. We've done a lot of work on the campus in terms of campus landscaping. We've really beautified the campus. We've completely renovated the dining facilities for the residential halls. We have done a lot of renovation and construction in our residential halls with Armstrong dorms. And the most recent new addition to campus is the $20 million, 40,000 square foot new student center, the Nick and Lou Martin University Center. And Lou, thank you so very much for making that possible for us to be able to do that. It's been an absolutely wonderful addition to the campus, and is now a meeting place, not only for our students and our organizations and activities, but for the community. And I know many of you have been able to attend events that have been held there just over the last year and a half. The most recent addition that's not quite finished yet is a new 101-bed apartment complex called the Rosedale, which is being built directly across the street on land that the university owns by a private developer, and it will open this next summer. So it's the next big step that we're making to try to continue to improve and economically revitalize our part of Southeast Fort Worth. The next project that's on the books is to renovate our dorms. This is what will soon be the before picture, and this will be the after picture for the labs in our science building. It's in the dorms, the labs in our science building. The McFadden Science Building was built back in 1967. It's a wonderful building, but the labs haven't been improved much since that time. So this will be an extraordinary step forward. It's about a $1.3 million project, and we're in the process of raising funds for that right now. But the biggest thing that has happened to our neighborhood and to the university in a long, long time is the new athletic stadium. I think you all know that about 5 years ago, we restarted football. The university had football until 1941, and after Pearl Harbor, the team members got together and decided to disband the team, and they all went off to war. After the war was over, the university restarted many of its other athletic programs, but for various reasons did not restart football. So about 5 years ago, the Board of Trustees made the decision that we would move forward with reinstating football. And the first year that we had football, the most popular t-shirt on campus said, "Texas Wesleyan University football, undefeated since 1941. And then we played our first game. But Joe has done a lot of really, really great things since that time, and he's going to be able to tell you a lot about it. The athletic stadium is going to be about a 3,000 to 5,000 seat stadium on campus, directly off of Rosedale. And it is going to be named the Karen Kramer Stadium. And Karen, thank you so very much for being here with us. Thank you for making this possible. It will be one of only two or three athletic stadiums in the entire country named for a woman, and we're so excited that ours is going to be one of those. At this time, it's my great pleasure to introduce Joe Prudhomme, who's the coach of our football program. And I want to tell a little story. When we first began interviewing for coaches at Texas Wesleyan University, when we created football, when we brought football back, it got a lot of attention, a lot of national attention, that we were bringing football back to Texas Wesleyan University. It also brought attention from a lot of people who wanted to be the coach of this new program, including a retired coach who had been head coach at two different SEC schools. The athletic director, Steve Tratcher, at the time, and I talked a lot about exactly what we wanted in a head football coach. And what we wanted was someone who was dedicated to the student in student athlete. And we are so delighted that we decided not to go in the direction of a retired SEC head football coach and go in the direction of someone who was concerned about not only the on-field development of the player, but the off-field development of the student as a son.
the vision, because it's the one I've always shared. Fred's already said it. You know, the build, you know, we want to build great young men. And that's always been my mantra. And when you hire young coaches, and I have hired some young coaches, and they look at you and want to know what your hashtag is, and I didn't know what they were talking about at the time, still struggle with it, be honest with you. What is your motto? What's our motto? What's this year going to be about? You know what's going to be about? What it's always been about. Build great young men. Everybody has to have a touchstone. You have to have a rock that you always go back to. And that's always been our rock. Fred kind of stole my thunder a little bit on that, but the guys that we get, a lot of them aren't there yet. Matter of fact, none of them are there, because it's a journey for all of us, is it not? To continue to evolve, to continue to get better. But, you know, I have conversations when I'm recruiting and talking to guys, and when they use that NFL term three or four times on time, and I'm patient, I'm a really patient person, you know, but when you get to that fifth time and you're still saying, I'm so sorry, this probably isn't a fit for you. I want to know what you see yourself in 10 years, 20 years, and 40 years. They kind of look at me, and let's be real. In this generation, a lot of them, if they can get to 15 minutes ahead, they're doing well, you know. So you get that vision, and now you got to have abstract thinkers, guys that can think ahead and really see what you're talking about. And that's what we do. We have my conversations in recruiting and hiring coaches is mainly about where are you from? What do you want to be? And what can we do to help you get there? But we can bring you there, but we can't make you drink, right? So we can give you opportunities. But if I get that NFL over and over again, I lose interest pretty quick, and then we move on down the road from there. When I hire coaches, I have two or three rules about hiring coaches. Number one, they have to love my kids, okay? Because they are my kids, you know, and I look at them that way, and that's the way I treat them all. Number two, I have a rule that I don't hire transactional coaches. If you know what the difference between transactional and transformational are, right? So you see these coaches all the time. Well, if I get this guy and I get that guy, then hey, man, you know what? We're on to the next job. That's not me. That's not me. I hired a couple in my career, one at Nolan, one at Wesleyan. Both of them had very short stints, only months. Because when you sign on with us, it's about transforming them to where they can go and where they can be. And my third one is, and it's become even more prominent of late, you got to have a sense of humor. You got to have a sense of humor. You can't control what you can't control. And if you can't control it, don't let it control you. And I make that really, really evident in our conversations. So I take the job. They hand me a list. Marketing, you know, they blew it up. They were recruiting. They handed me a paper. It had 687 names on it. Okay, of people that had shown interest, and they wanted me to contact them and recruit all these people. And I'm like, okay, all right, well, I'm going to start. I'm going to try. I didn't have a coach for three months, I guess, at the time. So I sit down, I start trying to contact these people. And then I knew that there was a setup. You know, there's always some setup somewhere, because they planted their own names in some of this part. I'm like, what is going on? So then I end up calling them, and you know, you get tired and you start to really go with it. And because I would get up at 7 in the morning, and I wouldn't finish until after 2 or 3 in the morning most days in that first 6 months of recruiting, because there's a thing called East Coast and West Coast, right? So when you're talking to all the East Coast guys, you start early, and the West Coast guys, you finish up with the California kids. So I'm recruiting. We get the kids in, charged with bringing in 75 kids, first year for a redshirt class. We brought in over 140. That's on three coaches. Now, when I'm saying 140, I know a lot of you are thinking those young stallions walking across that are awesome. I had a 48-year-old. I had all kinds of people showing up. I mean, at times it was almost a clown show, you know? And I'm like, well, I guess this is how we're going to start out. It's a little bit like that. And you know, so I saw the whole motto, and it's our sales slogan, a smaller, smarter. And you know what? I made the mistake of thinking it was a directive and not a motto the first couple of years, and we were little bitty, and we got our butts kicked. We were we didn't win a game first year. Second game, we won one or two. Next year, we won three. But that third year, 19, we were close in three different games where it came down to the last play. So my process, our process is not quick. I don't go get a bunch of transfers in and finish it up. It takes patience. But if any of you have ever eaten gumbo, and I pray to God everybody has in this room has eaten gumbo at some point. If you rush a gumbo, what happens? You burn it, you screw it up, and it's not right. So that's kind of how I approach football.
You got to take your time, you got to do it right, you got to have the right ingredients, and you can't have too many cooks in the kitchen. They start throwing in sausage and chicken and crap like that when you want seafood, right? And so we ended up getting that all gathered up, going the right direction, doing what we're doing, rolling on down the road. We recruited some kids out of Mississippi, got a lot of local kids, got a lot of DFW, a lot of the others, but I just want to tell a few success stories. And like I said, I'm on a clock, so don't worry about it. I will keep you on time, because man, I don't face it, bring it home if I screw it up. So the as far as bringing in our kids, we recruited some kids out of Mississippi, and in one of the rooms, I'll never forget, because I went in his house, the floor had dirt, and that blew my mind. I'm like, that can't be. That kid now is an analyst at Lockheed Martin. Yeah, I'm proud of that. I mean, that's really good. Had another young man that showed up, and he was homeless at the time. He had gone to Texas Southern, and he went and he did what we call, the catfish. They give you everything up front. Oh, it's going to be great. And, he bombed a couple classes. They took away his money. He was homeless his second semester. And so actually second year, I'm sorry, his second year. And he was out of stop six, out of Dunbar, came home, came to one of our recruiting visits. He was homeless at the time, because he had to make a decision. I got to pay the tuition, or I got to have a place to eat and sleep. Well, he's a very charismatic, magnetic personality, and he decided he could just sleep his way on couches and trucks and all those things. And I met him, and you always got your radars up a little bit, and I'm like, I don't know if this is real or not. And the kid comes and he says, Coach, all I want to do, I want to get back to stop six. I want to get back to Dunbar, and I want to teach in the junior high. I said, okay. I said, so I'll just use a fake name. James, why? Why do you want to do that? I said, I get it. I coached and taught for a number of years, but junior high, as they lose their mind from sixth grade to eighth grade, and you want to be in that environment? Yeah, Coach, I want to be in that environment. I said, well, why is that? He goes, I can make a difference there. He said, by the time they hit high school, they've already made the decision that screwed up their life. He goes, I lost seven classmate teammates who were shot and killed or had violent endings. He goes, most of them don't even make the paper. He said, but if I can get there, I can help them change their lives. So I said, all right, we did everything we could. He came out, good football player, not a great player, but boy, he had fire. And that joker could play. He was hardcore about getting it done. About junior year, he starts to fade off a little bit. Actually, this is first semester, senior year, starts fading off, and he starts really acting out, really being a jerk. So I kicked him off the team, made a phone call to one of our mentor group, and I'll tell you a little bit about our mentor group. One of our mentors, I said, hey, Jeff, I got this kid, man. He needs your help. He needs some help. He needs some guidance. I've been working with him. I'm really excited about what his potential are. I told him what he was doing. He says, well, Greg, what positions do you play? What numbers? Yeah, I said, well, that's the kicker. I kicked him off the team. He goes, wow. He goes, you did that for a kid that, and I told him his story, where he wanted to go, what he wanted to do. He says, I'm in. He goes, if you care that much about that kid and he's that, I'm all in. So that was, and so he ended up graduating. He's at Dunbar. He's in junior high and he's teaching right now. And I couldn't be more proud of that. But one of the things I'll never forget, that summer after he graduated, he got his job. We went over and did a function with Dunbar High School. My kids, we go to Boys and Girls Club. We do various events. I think it's always better to give. You get so much more when you give than if you take and get all the time. So anyway, we were doing a deal with Dunbar High School in the summer. And there's a group of little junior high kids out there, and they're playing around and everything. And Mark comes up, and of course, everybody's hugging him and loving on him because he has that personality. And he goes up, he goes, oh, no, excuse my language, but I heard some other stuff from this guy, so I'm worried about too much. So he goes, oh, no, hell no. And he walks right past me. I go, what? I turn around, and he is he's headed to that little group of junior high kids who he'd been working with there in the summer. I looked over, there's three dudes, and these are some shady looking dudes coming out of the car. And they're walking over towards him. And he goes, oh, no. And he walks over to him. And the thing about this guy that I'm telling you about, he has true cred. They don't mess with him in East Fort Worth. He walks over, oh, no. And he goes over, takes care, and they're shaking their heads and they're doing all, and they walk off. Oh, Mark, what was that about? He goes, they were coming for that group. I go, what do you mean? They were going to recruit them for their gang. I went, whoa, it got real for me. I mean, it's already real, but it got really real for me. And when you start changing those kinds of young men's lives and they get an opportunity to go do great things, it's hard. I mean, it's hard to really do it and stay with it because there's so much about this job that is so hard. And Fred's already addressing the facilities piece. I mean, we practice at Hanley sometimes, we practice at Farrington sometimes, we practice wherever we can practice at times. We have a truck that was donated to us, right? And that's our equipment room. We are the rolling show, baby. We can get up and go anywhere we need to go. The rolling show, I don't know how many of y'all got that, but okay. So I just got to be a part of Roland's entourage today, and man, it's better than being in the harem, I'm sure, but I appreciate it, Roland. But for real though, In that environment, man, we get bumped. We'll be at practice one day, then we get a phone call at 1 o'clock, and then we got to get up and we got to move to somewhere else. So that part of it's really hard, but the things that come back is to be able to be in a setting where what you do and what you embrace about building great young men is celebrated. And it has real roots. It has real tangible signs of it, right? It's not the situation because, I mean, let's be real. Coach speak everywhere. Yeah, I'm going to do this. You look up and they get there hiring some dude that just robbed a bank. And you're like, okay, he's good though, right? Yeah. So you see those kinds of things and it's just like, no. And Fred embraces and gets the message of what we do and everybody understands it. And it'd been real easy to get rid of me after a year or two. We were terrible. But, you know, we had a process in place and, you know, and yeah, we lost the first game and we should have, we were terrible, but it was a situation where you gotta be patient. This way is the hard way. When you do it the easy way, is it really worth it? Is it really something you can be proud of? It's not for me, but we've turned the corner, okay? We really have. We were 7-3 this year. And one of those games was against Central Arkansas. That's a Division I team that beat, I think it's Jacksonville State, who beat Florida State, right? So I got something in common with Florida State. We both got our butts kicked by a pretty good team, right? But I bet Florida State didn't get the check like we did. So that's a little different deal. They were paying. I was getting, you know, our university was getting. But we lost two games. You know, we lost to Langston on three tip balls. If you've ever watched football, anytime somebody's in coverage and they're going back and they're falling back to reach up and they tip the ball and you're like, all right. And then he goes backwards and kicks it over his head to the guy in the zone. You already know you're done, right? So you just, then two more happen like that. But so we're really on the way and we've made some changes. Got some great coaches on board, had good coaches, and everybody served their purpose on the way up. Fran Johnson, who's with us here today, is our offensive coordinator. We made a change from the whole spread fast, play fast deal, which is great until you don't get first downs. And it sucks, right? Because you're on the field. I mean, your defense, they can get over to the sideline and they sit down, get water. Oh, crap, we got to go back out, you know, because you didn't get a first down, but you only burned up like 15 seconds off the clock. And so we went to more of a pro style, multi sets, really got a little better. But Fran got it. I mean, when we talked, you know, I was shocked he was available. It worked out. And we both have a very strong belief in God and in the believer. And I believe we were brought together on that deal. But, you know, it was patient. He talked about patience. He talked about a lot of the things and wanting to build great young men. And that's my staff, because if you don't do that, you're gone. I mean, it's just not a negotiable. You're done. So anyway, I got to hear, well, you're going to more conservative offense. Yeah, that's great. And I said, I wouldn't call it more conservative. I'd call it better football. So we did, and we ended up averaging 46 points a game. That's pretty good for a conservative football. I was really happy with that. But, you know, we're on the way. We've gotten a lot better. You know, I can't tell you how excited I am to even be able to be in this room with y'all. I'm actually humbled. You probably can't tell. I'm extremely intimidated to be in front of y'all because everybody here is so accomplished, and I'm still trying to climb up that side of that wall to get where I can get. But, you know, we're doing some great things over there. Like Fred said, you know, the stadium that's going to be built, I can't tell you, this could be life-changing for my kids, because my kids right now, they have a bag. They don't have a locker room. They have one at the school, but we're on the road. They walk with a bag. Can you imagine living in a bag? You know, all your equipment's in it, and wherever you go, and you got to know where it is. That's where we are, but that's being addressed, and we're going to build something great. And I hope a lot of you decide to say, hey, you know what? I want to be a part of something like that, because you can be a part of something that you make a big difference, and that whatever rock you throw in that lake makes a bigger ripple. But if you're going somewhere that's already established and it's already done, you ain't the reason it's happening. They did it with or without you. But with us, at least, like I tell my kids all the time, you get a chance to build history. You get a chance to make a real difference, not just something that, you know, it's the taglines, as I call it. Did I get that right, Carter? Is the tagline? Carter, stand up real quick. This is one of our kids that almost quit on me, almost went home after his freshman year. He screwed up academically. Yeah, look at him. He's a handsome kid. Outstanding kid. He's with his mentor, Jim Austin, and everybody knows great Jim Austin. If you don't, then you missed out, or you just ran, because that man will find you. That man will find you. But anyway, we have a mentor program because a real big part of that mentor program for us, for me, for my vision, you hear about it all the time, right? We got a mentor program, and you hear these universities talk about it, and they're talking about their seniors are taking in their freshmen. That's great. Then what happens, right? What happens? You graduate. Do you have the connections? Have you networked? Have you met people? Do you know what it is to go out and meet people? Do you know what it is to put yourself out there? Do you know what it is to get your resume from the bottom of the pile to the top of the pile? Well, you got to get your butt out, and you got to go meet people, and you got to do internships, and you got to do things of that nature. So we got about that first year, we had it really rolling. We got up to about 38, and it was February, third week in February 2020, we all know what happened, right? The whole world iced over. So we had to build that back up, but it's very real for us. The mentor program is really real. It works great. I got kids that, like I said, the Lockheed Martin analyst, he got that through a mentor. You get it from all these people that want to help you. And so that's where our mentor group's up to that group. If you're interested in that, please see me. I'll give you my information. I didn't bring business cards because I didn't think about it, but I got a picture of my card. I'll share it with you. But Collier's here doing it. He's almost walked away on us and would have really given it up. He's now positioned to get, he went from what, you were like a two, I don't even want to go where you were. He got all the way up to a three. And that's huge because now he can go and do the MBA program. We have several kids that have graduated from the MBA program who came to us from nothing. And I'm so proud of that. Yeah, you clap. That's good. You clap it out. I'm very proud. Both of my kids got their MBAs from Texas Wesleyan. They're doing great. So it's a place that, you know, we can really build something. We can continue to build something. And like I said, just thank you for the opportunity to have me. Thank you for putting up with me. I just pray to God I get a good reception at the house. So anyway, thank y'all.
I think maybe we just have a minute for questions or comments. But one thing that Joe didn't say is that he was named our Athletic Conference Coach of the Year in football last year. Questions? Yes.
When is your first public scrimmage in the spring?
Actually, it'll be April 23rd.
April 23rd. Anybody's always welcome to practices. If you ever want to come to a practice, we're over at Hanley. But April 23rd is going to be our spring game. Yes. Our first game is going to be against, it is Arkansas State. You got that. Cadetto campus. It is the first American university in Mexico, and they've started their football program. They're like year three, and they're coming to play us. It's the first game that I'm aware of where a Mexican team or Mexican university will play a team in the country. That's a real game, not an exhibition and not a scrimmage, but a real game. We are planning on a big, big celebration there because that's a really, really cool event. So that's going to be a big deal, and I'd be a part of, if you can get in on. Hugo's spearheading it for me. Hugo Martinez, please stand up real quick. He's the co-chair of our mentor group. So, and if all mentors here would stand up, all the mentors in our group, I know David Floyd, don't be shy back there. Come on, Roland. Come on, Whistle. Come on, some of those guys. So. There you go, Jim Austin. Absolutely. Other questions?
The good ones. All right. Thank you all very much. Oh, yeah.
You mentioned the exhibit that you have in your gallery right now. It's a collaboration with the Tarrant County Homeless Coalition.
And I will be remiss because I do not remember the name of it, but it's a local artist, and it's all about the spaces that with homeless individuals. It's at the Bernice Coulter Templeton Gallery on our campus, which is there on Vaughn, right next to Black Coffee. And so I would encourage everyone to come. I can't remember the name of the... Okay, great. Thank you all very much.
And it's a tradition of our club to donate a book to the Fort Worth Public Library in honor of your speech today. And there is a copy of the book plate. We have one for each here. Thank you very much for being with us today. All right. Thank you again to our sponsor, Don Boren. Sorry he couldn't be with us, but he graciously sponsored. Reminder that we have our bake sale for donations to the fund supporting Ukraine. You'll get a box of cupcakes. Got a couple here, I think, see Aurora. We're signing up for Great Decisions. See Aurora for that as well. There is no international committee meeting today, so strike that. We do have a Veterans and Military Support Committee meeting today, President's Room on the 11th floor. Membership directories are available. We went back to our print directory, so if you've not picked that up, see Aurora. And then we have our Peace for Ukraine signs, which yard signs, which are available as you go out today. Next week's program will be Mayor Maddie Parker. And with that, we are adjourned. Have a great weekend.